That's right.
You gotta come with us for Hajj.
Hajj? Yeah. I wanna bring somebody else with me.
Yeah, bring him.
Inshallah. How long do you need to fly somewhere now? 10 minutes.
10 minutes.
Ten minutes?
Just okay. Use this table sure. Over here. Can we put this in there?
Alright, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسولنا وبعد. So right before we broke for Salah, we were discussing verse number 15 from Surah An-Naml, in which Dawood and Sulaiman عليهم السلام, they are expressing their gratitude to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the unique and beneficial knowledge that He has granted to them. And that took us on this discussion regarding the importance, the significance of knowledge within our faith, within Islam. And that knowledge in and of itself is something that is highly regarded, and it is something that is considered to be an essential part of our faith. Because our faith, our belief, our practices are supposed to be built upon knowledge and understanding. Knowledge regarding Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, His existence, His oneness, His might, His power, His glory, His magnificence, and our knowledge regarding the life of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That anything that brings us closer to Allah and anything that increases our love for the Prophet ﷺ is considered to be beneficial knowledge that we are encouraged to seek, that we are encouraged to learn. So we were talking about a few of the narrations of the Prophet ﷺ that highlight the importance, the virtues, the blessings of seeking knowledge. So we discussed one of them in which the Prophet ﷺ described knowledge as inheritance. That this is the inheritance that has been left behind by all of the prophets and messengers, and that those who study and those who understand and the scholars are considered to be the heirs of the prophets. Right, there's another hadith narrated by Anas radiallahu an, where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told us, "Man kharaja fi talab al-ilm fahuwa fi sabilillahi hatta yarji'a." That whoever leaves home to seek knowledge, they are on the path of Allah till they return. So in this hadith, the Prophet ﷺ is telling us that if we leave the comfort of our homes and we set out and we physically travel and we go to a particular place, then as long as we're on that path, as long as we're traveling, as long as we're learning, we are considered to be fi sabilillah. We are considered to be on the path of Allah. And usually speaking, this expression fi sabilillah, it's used in the context of jihad. It's used in the context of struggling, in the context of struggling in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So seeking knowledge is considered to be a type of jihad. And the reason for that is because it's considered to be a struggle. So some of the scholars mention that in leaving home for seeking knowledge, one revives their religion. They humiliate Satan. And they place a burden on themselves by engaging in this activity. Because it does require some effort on our parts. It requires us to alter our schedule. It requires us to leave the comfort of our homes. It requires us to invest time and energy and effort and intellectual energy and mental capacity as well. So all of these are considered to be an aspect of struggle. Mu'adh radiallahu anhu would say that I advise you to seek knowledge because learning it is fear of Allah. That the only way to develop true fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is through knowledge, by learning about Him. Studying it is worship. So oftentimes when we think about ibadah, we think about praying, we think about fasting and reciting the Qur'an and giving charity. But Mu'adh ibn Jabal radiallahu anhu is saying that studying knowledge, learning and teaching and reading and revising is also considered to be an act of worship. Revising it is praising Allah. That revising whatever you've learned, reviewing whatever you've learned, it's an act of praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and seeking it is a struggle. Seeking it is jihad. And that is why some of the companions radiallahu anhum, they would say that if death comes to a student of knowledge while they're seeking knowledge, they are considered to be a shaheed. And one of the other reasons why it's being likened to the struggle is because our faith, our religion, is defended primarily in two ways. There's a physical defense, and then there's this intellectual defense by providing proofs and rational arguments. So all of us here tonight, we can be included within the virtue of this hadith. As a matter of fact, if we look at our particular situation today, seeking and gaining knowledge is one of the best ways that we can defend our religion. Right? One of the best ways that we can defend our faith, our beliefs, our values, our morals, is through knowledge. Because we know we're living in a social, political environment where our faith is constantly under attack.
that people are attacking us as Muslims, as a community. They're attacking our beliefs. They're attacking our morality. They're attacking our values. They're attacking all different aspects, even the theological aspects of our faith. And we as believers, we're responsible to come up with a defense for that. Right? We are responsible to respond to those things, to remove people's doubts. But the only way to do so is if we ourselves know. That we ourselves have to have this deep understanding of our faith, of our religion, of itself. And the Prophet ﷺ told us that طَلَبُ الْعِلْمِ فَرِيضَةٌ عَلَىٰ كُلِّ مُسْلِمٍ. That seeking knowledge is an obligation upon each and every single Muslim. So just like we understand praying five times a day is obligatory, we have to do it. Just like we understand fasting Ramadan is obligatory, we have to do it. Similarly, we should have the same understanding of knowledge. That this is something we have to do. This is not something optional. This is something that each and every single one of us should be engaged in. And the scholars, when describing this hadith, they say that knowledge here, it's not referring to getting a degree. It's not referring to getting a university education and pursuing a career. That's also important, that is significant, that is something that we have to do as well. That's also an obligation. But what is being referred to in this particular hadith is knowledge of Allah. Knowledge that increases our understanding of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and knowledge that increases our love for Him and for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And that is why they say that there are four major branches of knowledge that each of us have to learn. Right? Four major aspects of learning that each of us have to be engaged in. The first is ilm al-aqaid, knowledge of creed, knowledge of theology. That what is it that actually makes us Muslim? Right? What aspects of belief actually makes us believers? So as Muslims, what do we believe about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? What is this concept of tawheed? What are the divine attributes? What are the divine names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? So basically the Muslim understanding of the divine. Right? How do we understand, how do we perceive who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala truly is? So having this understanding of who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is, it's an obligation upon us. That is foundational for our relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Right? Understanding the concept of revelation, of scripture. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He revealed scripture to certain prophets throughout history. And the last and final scripture being the Qur'an. So understanding the Qur'an, its primary message, its themes, its concepts, how it is structured, its preservation, its history. Right? Everything related to the Qur'an is something that we should be engaged in learning. We should learn about the prophets and messengers. We should know about life after death, the day of judgment, and the angels, and the concept of qada and qadr. So having sound creed, having sound theology, it is an obligation. That is something that all of us have to learn. And being born into Islam, being born Muslims, oftentimes we don't really study this formally. Right? Our understanding of these concepts are things that we picked up perhaps from home, perhaps we pick it up from a random lecture here and there, maybe through Sunday school and weekend schools, whatever it may be. But oftentimes that is not enough to create a solid foundation in creed, a solid foundation in beliefs. And that is something that is incumbent, it is obligatory upon each and every single one of us to know. Because our faith is supposed to be not just faith, it's supposed to go towards yaqeen. It's supposed to become certainty. And the way we create that certainty, the way we strengthen our iman and our faith, is by actually learning about it. And that's why it's important for us to like study formally and study like have a structured way of actually understanding what our beliefs are and what we believe as Muslims. The second is what they call ilmu ahkam al-sharia, right? Knowledge of the rulings of sharia, especially when it comes to acts of worship. So those, that much knowledge that will allow us to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala correctly and properly. So for example, having knowledge of tahara, of purification. How do we purify our bodies and our clothes and ourselves for prayer? What is ritual purification? How do we perform wudu? What are things that nullify wudu? Right? How do we perform ghusl? What are the certain things that necessitate ghusl? When can we do tayammum? When can we can't do tayammum? And all of the things related to purity and purification. We need to understand the fiqh of prayer. Right? How do we pray properly according to the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? What are the fara'id? What are the wajibat? What are the sunan? What are the adab of prayer? What are the things that invalidate prayer? What are the things that break prayer? Right? What happens in certain scenarios in prayer? Same thing for fasting and zakah and hajj. So having that much knowledge is an obligation upon each and every single one of us. Why? Because we're obligated to do these things as acts of worship. So having a deep understanding of how they are performed properly is something that is mandatory, something that's obligatory upon all of us. The third branch, they say, is ilmul muharramat, right? Having an understanding of those things that Allah has prohibited. Because the only way to stay away from something prohibited is if we know that it's actually prohibited. So understanding some of these prohibitions set by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the third is what they call ilmu ahkam al-mu'amala wal-mu'ashara. Knowledge of the rules related to transactions, right? Transactions and dealings and social interactions. So al-mu'amala is referring to any financial transactions or business that we may be involved in, or even our profession. That what does Islam say about this source of livelihood, this source of income? Is it permissible or is it impermissible? Perhaps my profession as a doctor, are certain things that I do allowed by the Sharia or not? Can I prescribe this medicine that contains, I don't know, alcohol in it? Right? Can I prescribe this medicine that has traces of pig and I don't know, whatever else it may be? Or perhaps some of the bioethics involved with end-of-life care. As a doctor, am I allowed to do these things? So learning all of this is obligatory. So obviously, whatever field we're in, whatever profession we're involved in, Islam has something to say about it. It has some rules, it has some regulations, some boundaries, and we have to know what those rules, regulations, and boundaries are. And then ilmu ahkam al-mu'ashara, that as human beings, all of us play different roles in life. So some of us are fathers and brothers and children and neighbors and co-workers and classmates. As we play these roles, what are our rights? But most importantly, what are our responsibilities? That as a father, what are my responsibilities towards my children? As a husband, what are my responsibilities towards my wife? Right? As a son, what are the responsibilities towards my father and towards my mother? What are my responsibilities towards my neighbor? So having this foundation of knowledge is an obligation. طَلَبُ الْعِلْمِ فَرِيضَةٌ عَلَى كُلِّ مُسْلِمٍ. So having enough knowledge that allows us to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala properly is mandatory, it is an obligation upon each and every single one of us. Now, according to a lot of my teachers and mentors and a lot of contemporary scholars, the crisis of knowledge is perhaps the greatest crisis affecting the entire Muslim world. And the crisis, they say, it's not simple, it's very complex, it's multifaceted, with several different factors affecting it. And a major factor is a lack of a base level of literacy in Islamic studies, especially here in America. That when we look towards the Muslim American community, and we look at the level of literacy when it comes to creed, when it comes to theology, or even when it comes to fiqh, like the fiqh of purification, or even the fiqh of prayer, or even the fiqh of zakah, when it comes to Quranic studies, when it comes to hadith studies, even when it comes to the seerah of the Prophet ﷺ, we find that there's this huge vacuum. There's this huge lack of even this base level of literacy. And as a community, it is important for us to be honest and real with ourselves. That as a community, as a whole, our understanding of our faith and religion and its teachings oftentimes is very superficial, it's shallow. So we may think that we know our religion. And you know, I've heard a lot of people say this, that mashallah, I know my faith, I know my religion, I know Islam. But if we want to be really honest with ourselves, we want to be true to ourselves, we should realize that oftentimes our understanding of what is Islamic and what is not, or what's part of our religion and what is not, is oftentimes very shallow, it is very superficial. We have a particular perception of what Islam is, which would most likely be based on our personal experiences and circumstances, which is heavily influenced by the particular flavor or culture of Islam that we've been brought up in. So for most of us, what we know about Islam comes from what we've learned at home from our parents, maybe Sunday school, various talks and lectures, and nowadays, Sheikh Google and Mufti YouTube, right? These are our sources of knowledge. And the reason for that is because as a Muslim community in America, we are still in our stages of infancy. So our institutions are not fully developed as of yet. So for example, when I was growing up, there were not many opportunities to actually have a formal, structured, methodical way of studying Islam. Right? Our exposure to Islam is whatever we learned at home. Alhamdulillah, our parents, you know, most of our parents do a good job. They try to instill faith within us, you know, try to make, you know, instill practices of praying and fasting, etc. But oftentimes that's not enough. Right? That's their cultural understanding of how they understood Islam. And then we were perhaps exposed to a Sunday school on a weekend. But Sunday school on a weekend oftentimes is not enough, because we're spending the vast majority of our time in schools, in public schools, and colleges and universities, and we're being exposed to all of these ideas and philosophies and worldviews that are oftentimes contradictory to Islam. So our footing and our grounding, our understanding of religion, oftentimes it is shallow, it is not very in-depth. And oftentimes our understanding of Islam, it's very ritualistic and formal. It's based on the form, but it's missing the substance. That we might know how to pray, but why are we praying? Right? We might know the words of prayer, but what do these words actually mean? Right? We might be fasting in the month of Ramadan, but what's the purpose behind it? Right? We might be paying zakah, but why are we paying zakah? So we might know the ritual aspect, the ritual form behind it, but the meaning, the substance behind it is lost. And not to make any of us feel bad or to put anyone down, but a real question we should ask ourselves is how many of us actually understand the Qur'an? Right? How many of us within our community, within our homes, within our families, our circle of friends, how many of us truly understand the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? It's history. Right? What's the history of revelation? When did revelation start? How did it come to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? How was the Qur'an preserved? When was the Qur'an compiled? Its subject matter, its themes, its structure. Right? How can we be true people of faith when we can't meaningfully engage with the primary source of our faith? Right? How can we be true people of Iman if we do not have the ability to engage with the Qur'an, which is the primary source of our faith, the primary source of our religion? So seeking this base level of literacy is an obligation upon each and every single one of us. All of us should be literate when it comes to theology, especially the six articles of faith. Right? They say Arkanul Iman, the six articles of faith. Belief in Allah, His angels, His books, His prophets, the last day, and belief in divine decree. So these six articles of faith, all of us should have a deep understanding that what do each of these six things refer to and what do we believe regarding them. That is something that all of us should know, that base level of literacy. When it comes to fiqh, right, the basic understandings of purification and prayer and fasting and zakah and hajj. When it comes to business transactions, a basic understanding of what's permissible, what's impermissible. When it comes to the Qur'an, a basic understanding of how the Qur'an is structured. Right? How many surahs are there are in the Qur'an? What are the major topics? What are the major themes? What are the major subjects covered in the Qur'an? Same thing for hadith. How were the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ preserved? How were they compiled? Right? What do the hadith speak about? What is the importance and significance of hadith in relation to the Qur'an? So having this base level of literacy is something that all of us have to have. Why? Because that is what's going to allow us to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in a manner that is pleasing to Him. That's what's going to give us success in this world and in the world to come. Now this doesn't mean that everyone has to become a scholar. Right? Not every single one of us has to become a scholar. Rather, everyone has to learn enough knowledge that will allow them to worship their Creator properly with understanding. And another aspect of this crisis is that there is a clash in our communities of two very, very different worldviews. There's a worldview that is based in revelation through the Qur'an and Sunnah, in opposition to a worldview that is the result of the contemporary, secular, liberal world of the modern West, that is somehow perceived to be rooted in rational thought. And this is a really big struggle that we find amongst especially our youth. Right? Those students and those children of ours that are currently in college or in high school, this is one of the greatest challenges they face. That there is a particular worldview that is espoused by the Qur'an and Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. Right? How we're supposed to view and understand the world through the lens of revelation. And then they're exposed to different worldviews in school, which is oftentimes based on modernism and secularism and liberalism. And oftentimes the morals, the values, the ethics, the beliefs of those systems is completely opposite to those of Islam. And for some reason, those worldviews and those isms and those philosophies and ideologies, they are thought to be rational. Whereas belief in religion and God is seen to be irrational. It's not based in science, it's not based in rational thought. So whether we like to admit it or not, we are heavily influenced by the society and culture we live in. And that is a reality that none of us can deny. That whatever environment we find ourselves to be in, we will be heavily, heavily influenced by that environment, by that culture. Specifically, the Western education system of public and private schools and universities that most of us are products of. So we have knowingly or unknowingly adopted a value system and way of life that is based on modernity, liberalism, and secularism. So for example, our understanding of the concepts of freedom and justice and liberty, equality, mercy, and fairness are informed through a very liberal and secular lens. And because of that, we impose our understanding of these concepts onto verses of the Quran and Hadith, and we end up finding certain verses or a hadith to be problematic. So there ends up being this internal conflict within ourselves that leads towards a lot of doubts and a lot of confusion. As a matter of fact, this is one of the major inroads towards doubts in a person's faith. So one of the crises that we're dealing with, especially with youth here in America, well, actually all over the Muslim world, is this crisis of faith. That students and children are going through this crisis of faith. And oftentimes when you look at the root cause, one of the avenues towards doubt and one of the avenues towards this crisis is this clash between two world views. That they cannot reconcile what they believe with what Islam tells us. And a good example of that would be this event that happened yesterday. Right? Professor Stephen Hawking passed away. Right? So there are some Muslims who celebrated him and celebrate his life. And okay, we celebrate his achievements. He was an intellectual, great scientist, etc. But then there are people who are making dua for his forgiveness. And they're making dua that Allah have mercy on him and perhaps give him paradise. Because they cannot reconcile in their brains that if we have an all-merciful Lord, if Allah is Ar-Rahman and Ar-Rahim, then why would He punish a person who's good? Right? Why would Allah punish a person in the hereafter who's considered to be good? Right? That is something that people have this internal conflict with. That if we preach and if we teach that Allah is the most merciful, the most forgiving, etc., then how is it that He could punish someone who did good deeds who may not have believed in Him? So that has to do with the aspect of misunderstanding the concept of Allah's mercy. Right? Our understanding of mercy is not based on secular liberalism. It's not based on liberalism, period. It's not based on the secular understanding. Our understanding of mercy is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us His mercy is. Right? Whatever Allah does, that is what is mercy. Whatever Allah decrees, whatever He decides, whatever He judges and rules by, that is what we consider to be His rahmah. And we know that Allah's mercy encompasses every single thing. But in order to earn that mercy in the akhirah, you have to be a what? Have to be a believer. Right? In order to earn Allah's mercy in the akhirah, you have to have faith, you have to believe in the existence and oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that has always been the orthodox position of Muslims throughout history. That if a person wants to attain salvation in the hereafter, then they have to be people of faith. That there's only one way, there's only one path towards salvation. There aren't these multiple paths and multiple ways just because you do righteous deeds. In terms of mercy, they will receive that mercy in this world. They may receive blessings in this world or whatever else it may be. But this is the internal conflict that people then have. Because we are not grounded in our own faith. We're not grounded in our own religion. And we're not grounded in our own system of knowledge. And that is why knowledge and ilm is so significant. It is so important. And that is why all of us here, we should constantly be engaged in some sort of activity which we're constantly learning. There is no level of learning that is enough. You can constantly learn and you are a student for the rest of your life. There are constantly things that you can always learn and increase your knowledge and understanding regarding them. Right? And that is why it is extremely important for us to be engaged in learning and to learn formally, to learn in a structured manner. But most importantly for our children. Right? Our children should be involved in some sort of Islamic educational activity. And to be honest, right, just to be pure honest, Sunday school is not enough. Right? A Sunday school, 2 hours a day, is not enough for an Islamic education for our children. Because they're spending the vast majority of their time in either public schools and private schools or universities. And those places, in terms of faith, in terms of iman, in terms of moral, they're toxic. They're going to corrupt the minds of our children. They're going to corrupt their understanding of certain things. And it's going to lead towards doubts. And the way to protect them from that is by making sure they understand their religion in the first place. Making sure they understand who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is. And that's actually what it goes back to. Right? Placing faith in their hearts from that very young age and have them have that deep understanding of who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is and what their religion is and what their religion teaches. And if they're equipped with that, then they're able to go and they're able to navigate through the challenges they'll face on campus. Right? The example that they give is you want to teach your child how to swim. You want to teach your child how to swim. One way is just to throw him in the pool. What's most likely going to happen? Going to drown. Right? And there's another way that you show him some videos and you teach him how to swim and you go through some techniques and then you put on some floating devices on him and you keep him protected and safe. Then you do what? Then you throw him in the pool. Right? So that's an analogy that we could use for this. That if we're going to put our children in this environment, right? In this environment, which oftentimes contradicts our faith and contradicts our values and our morals and our principles, then we should send them into that environment being prepared. Right? You cannot put someone in front of a 18-wheel truck that's going 100 miles per hour and expect them to survive. Right? You have to give them protection. You have to give them the tools that they can use to navigate through these challenges and through these difficulties. And that is heavily rooted in knowledge. And the reason why I'm mentioning all of this is because وَلَقَدْ آتَيْنَا دَاوُدَ وَسُلَيْمَانَ عِلْمًا, that truly we gave Dawood and Sulaiman knowledge. وَقَالَ الْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ الَّذِي فَضَّلَنَا عَلَى كَثِيرٍ مِّنْ عِبَادِهِ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. And they said, all praise belongs to Allah who favored us over many of His servants, many of His believing servants. So if we want that favor, we want that blessing, we have to put in the effort, you have to put in the time to study. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala inshallah to make us amongst those who recognize the importance and significance of knowledge. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us the tawfiq, the ability to study, to learn, and most importantly, to implement what we learn. And to bring the teachings of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the message of the Qur'an into our lives. Are there any questions before we end for tonight? Go ahead.
Systems are based upon irrationality or just blind acceptance. That has again a lot to do with the fact that the type of religion they were exposed to as well. In essence, and I've had a lot of discussions with many youngsters and people who even were among the lost crowd. And what I often find out is that you take them back to the fundamental system of both, and you'll find actually that the Islamic belief system stands on real solid ground, whereas the other belief systems, they completely break down. But the question that I have is, now, in spite of you presenting this, still, you find those people, especially if they've grown up, let's say, having a not-so-good view of Islam or having a not-so-good impression of Muslims and Islam growing up, in the household or their environment or society at large, or they just weren't given that exposure, they still latch on to that. And it's funny to see, is that you take them back to the discussion of the fundamental beliefs, now they seem to be the ones that are adhering to their blind.
Yeah.
I think part
of that is oftentimes those people that end up latching onto maybe these like doubts and false notions is because of like personal trauma they experience within Islam and from Muslims themselves. So even though like rationally they might be convinced that Islam is correct, they won't accept it just because of what they've seen. And at the end of the day, you have to recognize that hidayah comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So they know the truth, it's in front of them, and they know they don't have like a really rational basis to argue against it. But at the end of the day, that guidance is going to come to them from Allah. And that is why if it's rooted in them from a very young age, then even if they go through that process of like doubts and like wavering, if that foundation was strong, eventually they'll come back. And that's our hope, inshallah, that hidayah comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Yeah, to follow this good question, one thing is so short, and he said, right, that our parents, for example, were not that much educated as we are. But still, they taught us the basic knowledge of Islam, right? Based on that one, we need our education on that. It's still good. Still behind it.
And
we understand it.
Yeah. And that's actually a big difference we notice from the older generation and the younger generation. So, for example, people of the older generation in their maybe 40s, 50s, and up, that if they have doubts, those doubts won't cause them to leave Islam. They might have doubts. They might have these questions. But at the end of the day, they still say, "What? Where?" We're Muslim. But the younger generation, if they have this doubt, automatically they're what? We're out. This doesn't make sense, so we're gone. Which is interesting. So that means like that there's a difference in upbringing. There's a difference in tarbiyah. There's some gap. There's something missing there.
Another
generally in the madrasas and all that, you know, they are not that educated. Actually, this sometimes they give the wrong education. Because of that, a lot of people, you know, they deviate and betray from the Islam.
Yeah, that's a societal problem there. Definitely. All right, so next week we will continue with Surah An-Naml and we'll pick up from verse number 16 and we will cover the story of Sulaiman with the ant, with the namla, inshallah. May Allah accept us from us and place on our scale of good deeds on the day of judgment. Subhanallah bihamdihi, subhanakallah bihamdik, nashadu an la ilaha illa anta, nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk. Jazakumullah khairan, wassalamu alaykum wa rahmatullah.